Briar Hill Baptist Church this morning. We're excited to see you here this morning. If you're a guest with us this morning, I want to just thank you for being here with us. We're excited that you're here. We hope that you have a meaningful time of worship this morning. We want to invite you to partake in our Lord's Supper later today. If you're a Christian, we encourage you to take part of that as well. We'll explain more of that as we go on. If you are a guest this morning, you'll see in the bulletin there's a little tear-off. If you would, just fill that out. We love a record of your visit, and it's a good way to find out more information about our church, too. Just if you have any questions about anything, you can do that. Of course, you can contact the church office at any time or stop and grab one of our staff members. We'll be glad to talk with you. On the other side of that is prayer requests. That's for members and visitors and regular attenders. If there's anything that you would like our staff to pray with you about, pray for you about, we'd love to do that. If you would, just fill that out as well. As the offering plate goes by, you can just drop that in there. You see in the bulletin and the announcement slide, there's a lot of things going on right now. I want to remind you that later today, we're going to continue with our kickoff yearly church year meetings with our committees. Last week was, I thought, very successful. Thank you to all who came. I think out of all the committees that met last week, one didn't get to meet, but we'll get schedule that as a time pretty soon. Today's meetings, just in case, I don't think it's in the bulletin, but today at 3 o'clock, the Building and Grounds Committee, the History Committee, the Music Committee, Transportation Committee, and the Wedding Committees will all meet. They'll meet back here behind the fellowship hall in those classrooms back there, which is right above the children's wing. And then at 3:45 in the same area, the Baptism Committee, the Greens Committee, and the Recreation Committee will meet. There's signs already on the doors to tell you where to go. That's just a quick meeting to kind of get the things kicked off for the year. You'll see the other things in the bulletin. You know that right now, Dare Our Love Does emphasis is our Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes. We have some of these put together. You can pick them up in the long hallway. Several have been picked up. I want to remind you, as you pick up a shoebox, for every shoebox that you pick up, please pick up one of these as well. This will give you a lot more information about what goes in, what goes out, and explains the process of Operation Christmas Child. But also in the back, you can designate whether it's a boy gift or a girl gift in the age range as well, and also gives you some opportunities where you can pay for the shipping. The shipping this year is $9, so make sure that's included as well. If you want to just donate items toward shoeboxes, our kids, our students will meet a little bit in the next few weeks and start processing boxes and making some from leftover items and items that people are buying. If you'd rather just pay shipping towards some of those boxes that we'll put together, again, that's $9 a box, you can do that. Write the check to Operation Christmas Child. You can give it to the church office or whatever you want to do, or designate it, and we'll get it to the right place. Several other things going on this afternoon. The kids will be here at 5:30. Kids are going to lead us in worship tonight, so you want to be here and be a part of that and experience that. It's going to be a fun time. Magic Club, don't forget about the trips coming up. On the Wednesday, October the 10th, not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday. The bulletin says 9, but we're going to try to meet a little bit earlier than that, so try to be here at 8:30. There's sign-up sheets. You probably saw those in your Sunday school class. There's one at the Welcome Center. Make sure you fill those out. We'll get that information so that we make sure we have enough transportation and everything's planned accordingly. Also, don't forget about for our new members, prospective members, had a lot of questions about that already this morning. Starting point, it's going to be just 3 weeks. It'll be during the Sunday school hour. We'll meet in the fellowship hall. So if you want to do that, let me know. There's sign-up sheets all over this place. You can fill that out. But it's going to be a good time to kind of get to know what's going on with our church, how you can be involved. I guarantee, even if you've been here for several months, even a year or two, I guarantee you probably learned at least one thing that you didn't already know about Briar Hill Baptist Church. And if you do, if you don't, then you'll get your money back. How about that? Miss Dorothy Kettleman is going to come up and share a little bit about our Margaret Lackey missions offering and some things that she's done and how she's seen that offering go to serve our kingdom.
Good morning. Well, I just wanted to share just a couple of things with you this morning about the Margaret Lackey offering and the criminal justice system. It's often been said that Margaret Lackey has a lifetime sentence without the possibility of parole because she's been in prison for a long time. But I had no clue, and you probably didn't either, that $65,000 is set aside each year for the criminal justice system, and this is to go to buy materials and to pay people to go in and minister. And another reason is that there are 22,000 Mississippians locked up at this particular time. 98% of those will return to the outside world. Will they return a new person in Jesus? Well, they won't if we don't go in and tell them about Jesus. And there's another 35 to 40,000 that are on parole. So if you add all these up, that's like 62,000. And then if you include their families, you're talking a 500,000 people. So that's a pretty big mission field. And as a volunteer prison chaplain out there, of course, my biggest concern has always been for the children. My heart is for the children. And they're the innocent ones that are caught up in this web. Because we all know that changed parents make better lives for their children. And I want to repeat that. Changed parents make better lives for their children, for everybody. And so, but only God can change lives. And I have a letter here I want to read very quickly. It's from the Tell This People Prison Ministry, and it's from an 8-year-old girl named Maria, and this is a true story. She said, "My name is Maria, and I'm 8 years old. Today I visited my mom in prison. I was happy to see my mom, but scared of the strange place with the high fencing. An officer in a blue shirt made me feel safe as she held my hand. We went to the visitation center, and I was scanned just like at the airport. My mom's name is Julie. She's 36 years old. She broke some adult rules, so a judge ordered her to live in the prison for 4 years. She cannot leave the state prison, but if she obeys the rules, she can get out sooner. My mom told me she lives in a building with many bunk beds. She sleeps on the bottom bunk, and there's a bulletin board for pictures in the building, so I gave her some of my artwork to hang. She complains about her food in prison because it is not homemade. She told me there are many rules in prison that cannot be broken. My mom told me that she's going to start classes 4 days a week. It is called the 1A program, and it lasts 6 months. She goes to an art class, a Bible study, a job skills class, and said she learns many important things in her classes. They give her books to study and read, and all of these materials are paid for by the Margaret Lackey Mission Offering. My mom told me that some Mississippi missionaries from Briar Hill Church came and told her about Jesus one day in one of her classes. She said she prayed and asked Jesus to come in her life and be her Lord and Savior. So now she reads and studies her Bible. When the visit ended today, I was sad. My mom cried and said she misses me a lot. She asked me to forgive her for breaking the rules so that she cannot live with me. She wants me to pray and ask Jesus to help her keep the prison rules so she can come home soon. I am so happy. Jesus is changing my mom in prison. Thanks to the Margaret Lackey State Missions Offering, the missionaries were able to visit the prison and tell my mom about Jesus." So we still have time to, if you have not given this month, to give something to Margaret Lackey. And if you haven't given or can't give, just please pray for these children. They're the innocent ones that are caught up in this web. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Dorothy. It's great to hear that our offering does go toward serving and growing God's kingdom. So it's great to hear about what's going on in our prison ministries. We're about a third of our way toward our goal. So as she mentioned, you can give toward that as God leads you to do. Before we continue in our time of worship, I'm pretty sure that in a crowd this size, we've probably got a lot of things going on in our hearts, in our minds, in our lives. Let's just pause for a minute and just spend some time with God. Ask Him to help us focus on Him this morning so we worship Him and experience Him and just allow the Holy Spirit to move in our life through the worship time, through the preaching time, through everything that happens here, that God will have His way. Pray with me. Father, we thank You so much for this day. Father, we thank You so much for this hour to be in Your house, Father. We just pray, Father, that You would just look into our hearts, Father. Forgive us, Father. We are sinful people. God, I just pray that the things that are going on, Father, our thoughts are probably in many other directions than right here this morning. So, Father, I pray that we concentrate on You. Father, I pray that Your Spirit move amongst this place, Father. There will be no hesitation, Father, for us to lean into You, Father, this morning. And I pray as we worship You, God, that through the words that we say, the melodies that are sung and played, Father, that it just be pleasing to only Your ear. And, Father, I pray that as the word is presented to us, it will be presented boldly, clearly, Father, and we'll be obedient to your word, Father. I pray if there's one in here who is lost, Father, I pray that there's one in here who may have strayed away from you, Father, that they'll find their way back to you this morning, Father, that they would find find hope, Father, find grace, Father, through only your Son, Father. As we celebrate what Christ did on the cross and his life, what it means for us later in the time of communion, Father, I pray that it be just a continuation of our worship this morning, Father. We thank you for this time, and may you be glorified through all that's said and done. It's in your Son's name we do pray. Amen.
I'd like for us to read that together this morning. I will extol you, my God, say it with me, O King, and I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you, and I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable.
Thank you. Victory! Father God, we thank you for another awesome and wonderful day, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity to come worship your name, Father, to sing praises to you and for your glory. Lord, I pray that you be with us this morning, Lord, that you forgive us. Lord, make us new. Lord, let us hear your word. Lord, let it enter our hearts. And let us live for you. Father, be with us now as we gather these tithes and these offerings. Lord, let them go to further your kingdom. Father, thank you so much for Jesus. It's in his holy, precious name we pray.
Swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you. have a Bible, turn to the book of Philippians chapter 1, and we'll begin in verse 12. And if you'll come for every service of this series in Philippians, you will have read the book of Philippians through with me. And if we get nothing else out of the series, that will be something worth getting. Amen. We're not going to preach all of these verses, but we want you to hear all of these verses from chapter 1, verse 12, all the way through verse 30. I want you to know, brethren, that the things which have happened to me, and the me in this book is Paul the Apostle, who is in prison at the writing of this book, this letter to the Philippian church. He says, the things that have happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel, so that it has become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ. And most of the brethren in the Lord, having become confident by my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ, even from envy and strife, and some also from goodwill. The former preach Christ from selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my chains, but the latter out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached. And in this I rejoice and will rejoice. For I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But I live on in the flesh. This will mean fruit from my labor, yet what I shall choose I cannot tell. For I am hard-pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more needful for you. And being confident of this, I know that I shall remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy of faith, that your rejoicing for me may be abundant, more abundant in Jesus Christ by my coming to you again. Only let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, and not in any way terrified by your adversaries, which is to them a proof of perdition, but to you of salvation, and that from God. For to you it has been granted on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me and now hear is in me. Chapter 2, verse 1 says, therefore, and so next time we will rehearse for you yet again these things and remind you why that word is there. But today, very shortly, I want to remind you that this is a book about joy, not happiness, not necessarily a smile on your face, and not necessarily a whoo-hoo, yee-haw kind of a happy or joy either, but just a thoroughgoing, solid, abiding peace that is found in the Lord Jesus Christ and a delight in him. And he is your pleasure. That's the kind of joy that we're talking about in this passage today. Paul said that he had some joy in his own life, and he tells us why. And then he said, my prayer for those Philippian people was that they would have joy in their lives as well. And he tells us why and how. And so those whys for those people are the whys in the house for us as well today. Now, very quickly, you see that we have the Lord's Supper prepared today, right? And so we're going to invite you to come to the table before we're finished here today. We're going to come and remember what we have in Christ. We're going to remember the death and the burial and the resurrection of Christ. We'll remember in particular the shed blood and the broken body of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want you to think in your mind and in your heart solemnly just now and in a very deep and meaningful way that everything that we do here from this moment on is all about Jesus. Amen? It is all about Jesus, and this table is going to be the centerpiece of what we will do here today because it represents the one who is the center of all that we do as Christians. We find our joy in Christ Jesus. That's the title of the message today, as a matter of fact. And Paul is giving us, in Philippians chapter 1, verses 12 through 30, he's giving us some insight into his situation and how he is joyful, and every time that he does, he points us back to the Lord Jesus Christ, points to the Lord Jesus. Even in the midst of whatever's going on in his life, he says, Jesus is my everything. And because of that, Paul, in his place of prison, is joyful. Now, as I'm reading through here, I see, first of all, that problems come to everybody. Amen? Everybody here got a problem today? Hey, aren't you glad you got a problem? Means you're alive, I guess. I don't know. I even see young people raising their hand today saying, I got a problem. I won't say that they looked at mom and dad when they raised their hands, but everybody got problems, problems, problems. I don't care how old you are, you got problems. Paul had problems. He said, all these things, the things that have happened to me. And you get to thinking about what things happened to him. And before he ever gets to writing about this, he has already been through some horrific experiences. He has been rejected by the Jewish people that he had once been a leader of. He has suffered beatings and whippings and stripes, and he has been left for dead. He has been all kinds of stuff. Man, I'm glad I'm not Paul the Apostle, because, man, that guy went through the ringer. He had some problems. And even as he's writing this epistle, he is chained up between two guards, and he's thinking about God's work. And if you'd ask him, what is your greatest work? He would have said, oh, it's starting churches, just like he did at Philippi. And we know today that that's not right. That wasn't the greatest work that Paul ever did. The greatest work that Paul ever did was to write all of these wonderful epistles for us to still be reading 2,000 years ago. He wrote this stuff. 2,000 years later, we're still reading this stuff, and it still means something to us. It still is able to bring joy to us and to impact our lives. That's the greatest thing that was going on. And he says, you know, in some small sense, it kind of get a little inkling that that might take place. He says, all of these things that have happened to me, all of these problems, he said, you know, I just think I need to praise God for them because it has come to further my work. And we know that's true because he was in prison. I can read to you the book of Philippians and talk about that book. And it was now we see the furthering of the gospel. And it leads to praise. He said, man, I'm rejoicing. That means he has joy because it is furthering the gospel. Now, how many of us, though, can put ourselves in the place of Paul? How many of us could sit here today and say, yes, indeed, Brother Mal, I have problems. I have more problems than you want to know about. I have more problems than you have time to listen to. I have problems, problems, problems. How many of us can say we got those problems and yet those problems are leading to the praise of the Lord Jesus Christ? Too many of us wrestle with our problems and we wallow in the idea of having these problems and trying to figure out how we're going to get out of these situations. How are we going to get away from these problems? How are we going to solve our problems? And we allow those problems, as we focus on them, to take away our joy in the Lord. Now, what is it that Paul's going to say through the rest of this chapter and indeed through the rest of this book? Even though I am suffering with problems, I know that even my problems are bringing glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that's an oddball thing to say. Amen? It goes against the grain of what we're taught and what we hear in this world today, that problems are of your own making or someone else's making, and there's no good in any problem whatsoever. But Jesus says, you let these problems be used of me, and I will be sure that I get the glory for that if you will center your heart in Jesus Christ. Paul was not focused. Listen, he was not focused on his problems. He was focused on his Jesus. And so since he's focused on Jesus, he can let those problems lead him to a place of praise. He said, all these things have happened, but they've happened for the furtherance of the gospel. Praise the Lord. I rejoice in the things I've gone through. But secondly, you see that he's got some persecutors. He has some people who are persecuting him. And he even talks to the Philippians in those latter verses that we read about the adversaries that are wanting to terrify us. How many of you have some adversaries? How many of you have some enemies? How many feel like you got people that are just out to get you? People who are trying to do their best to make your life miserable. People that just want to hurt you. Most people feel like there's some like that in their lives. Paul says, man, I've got some people around here who are preaching Jesus, thinking that, hey, word will get back to me in prison. They're loose and they're free out there preaching Jesus, and they're hoping that word is going to get back to me as I'm sitting in this jail cell with soldiers chained up to me, and I'm not able to go out there and preach Jesus. They're hoping that it'll make me feel bad when I hear about it. That's what he's saying. They're out there preaching Jesus, and they're hoping that I'm going to feel bad about it because I'm not able to go out there and preach Jesus. He said some are preaching Jesus legitimately and honestly, but he said others are preaching Jesus because of envy and strife, thinking to add to my chains. He said, you know what? I don't care. That's really what he's saying. I don't care. I don't care why they're preaching Jesus. Whether they hate me and whether they want me to suffer because of it, doesn't matter, because it's not about me. It's about Jesus. And if Jesus is getting preached, he said, I'm happy. I'm joyful. I rejoice at the fact that Jesus is being preached. You hear about other churches, other preachers, other places where God is pouring out revival. How do you feel when you hear about those things? True Christian, like Paul, is going to say, hallelujah! Christ is preached. No matter how, you know, it's like that old report where the Baptist boy got up and he was giving a report to the board, and he said, well, we were down in our baptisms this year. We were down in our receipts. We were down in our attendance. But praise God, the Methodists did even worse. Paul says, no, that's not the way we are. Paul says, I don't care who you are, where you are, and what your motivation is. If you're preaching Christ and you're preaching the true gospel of Jesus Christ, he said, that gives me joy. It gives me joy. Now, how many of us are allowing persecutors to affect our lives. People talk about you. People will text about you. People will Facebook about you. Oh my, some people air out their dirty laundry on Facebook. You know, and you just have to go click and say unfollow. Oh, I'm scared to unfriend you because you might be mad, but I'm going to unfollow you. I'll guarantee it. Don't want to hear it. Don't want to see it. People are persecuting others in any way that they can, through any measure that they can. Maybe you have a persecutor in your life. Somebody's just rubbing you wrong and moving against you, and you know that, and you feel that, and you agonize over that, and it will rob you of your joy. I can tell you that firsthand. And what I need to learn, what we need to learn, is the truth of this scripture, that prosecutors and persecutors can lead to the preaching of Jesus Christ, and that's all that matters. It's the preaching of Jesus Christ, the praise of the Lord Jesus Christ. But then thirdly, as you're reading through here, you see that this prison has focused Paul a little bit. Paul had a lot of time just to sit around and think, and he was a thinker. Make no mistake about that. Paul was a deep thinking kind of a guy. And Paul has all of this time to sit in the jail cell and think through his theology, think through his life, think through the processes that he sees going on around him, to think through who the people are that are influencing him, hurting him, or encouraging him. He's thinking through all of that stuff. And so in the quietness and the stillness of a prison cell, he is able to focus. And where does that focus end up? It focuses on the power of God. He said, man, I realize that even in the midst of all that I'm going through, he said, I see the power of God. I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayer and supply of the Holy Spirit and in Jesus Christ. He said, I'm not going to be ashamed of anything, but with all boldness, whether by life or by death, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. I'm just letting you know, folks, prison has done me good because I'm able to focus on the power of God. How many of you feel like you're imprisoned today? You know, there are people who are addicted to things. There are people who can't get away from some aspect of life, and you feel like you're drowning and you're chained. You are bound to those things, and you'd wish that you could turn them loose. You wish you could be set free of those things. And let me tell you that it might be that God has brought that very thing into your life for such a time as this today, that you might focus on God's power. And when you focus on God's power, you're not focusing on yourself, you're not focusing on your own power and abilities, but you're focusing on the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, when I focus on me and my inabilities, that just kind of makes me sad. You know, I could give you a multitude of ways. I can remember the days when my dad always had this philosophy. He said, if we can get hold of it, we can pick it up. Don't hear me? If we can get hold of it, we can pick it up. I remember the days when I was young and strong and stout. And I could push cows around. I could pick up engines out of trucks all by myself. And these days, I struggle sometimes with that heavily laden fork. You know? You get to thinking about your own power, your own resources, your own abilities, and your own life, you can lose a little bit of vitality and joy and excitement. But if you're not focusing on yourself and you're focusing on God, you're focusing on the Lord Jesus Christ, you're focusing on who He is and what He can do for you, then our joy is restored. If you've lost your joy, it's because you're thinking about yourself too much. If you're in bondage to something or addicted to something, it's because you are too self-centered in many ways. And what you need is the power of God to break through and to break you and set you free and loose. Focus on Jesus. all the way through here, Paul says, my problems, man, help me to focus on Jesus, and so I have joy. Those who would persecute me, I'm not looking at them, I'm looking at Jesus, and so I can have joy. Even though I'm in prison and I am chained up and I can't go where I want to go and do what I want to do, I focus on the power of God and I realize I am happy and joyful. But then finally, he had this pressing longing in his heart for the presence of God. For me to live is Christ. That summarizes what we're trying to say. For him to live is Christ. He is centering his mind and his heart and his life in Jesus Christ through every problem that came his way. He is focusing on a person in every situation, and his name is Jesus, no matter who the persecutor may be. He is focusing not on that persecution and that persecutor, but he's focusing on Jesus, and it brings him joy. He is indeed chained up, and yet he focuses on Jesus, and he recognizes there is power. How can he do all of that? Because for him to live is Christ. He is centered in the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything that he did in his life, every aspect of his living, it was all about Jesus. And therefore, he had joy. Now, what he's telling us here, he says to live is Christ, but to die is gain. Man, I feel like that. I'm going to say it again, folks, and I mean it. If God came to get me today, I would rejoice. Now, invariably, I'll stand at the back. Somebody will walk by and say, I don't believe that. Something wrong with you. You ought not talk that way. Well, y'all just be ugly and silly about your Christianity if you want to, but that's one of the truths that I understand is this world is full of problems, it's full of persecutors, it's full of imprisoning things that go on. I've got a pressing longing to get out of this world and get on with Jesus. Paul said, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. I believe that. I believe it like Paul did, and I mean it when I say I can't wait. I'm looking forward to going to be with him. And when I think about the future, and I think about it in eternal ways, I get joy. If you're going to focus on this world and all the problems, all the persecution that you go through and all the bondage that is found in this world, I'll guarantee you, you're going to lose some of your joy. You're not going to be as joyful a Christian as you ought to be. But if you can focus on Christ in this world and you've got a longing to be with him and to be in his presence in the fullest sense of the word, I believe it'll bring joy to your life. The only problem is, folks, you better know Jesus Christ before you start thinking the way I'm thinking. Where are you going to go if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ? You're going to go to the devil, spend time in hell. That's the way young people say it. Only way we can go to heaven is if we set our mind and our heart and our affections upon Jesus Christ now. When we realize that Jesus Christ is the one who shed his blood, whose body was broken for us, sinners, that we might have eternal life. Only then can you really experience joy when you come to faith in Jesus Christ. There's some in this room today, probably, who have never come to faith in Christ. You've never surrendered your life to his lordship. I can just tell you, this world is going to stink till you do. This world is going to present problems to you that you don't have answers for. This world is going to persecute you, and you're going to suffer for reasons unknown to you. You're going to feel imprisoned and in bondage and restricted till you come to know Jesus. and He sets you free. And He gives you eternal life. And He overcomes those that fight against you. And He solves your problems. We're going to have a hymn of invitation. And this is an invitation with a twofold opportunity. Number one, it's for people who've never come to Jesus. We want to invite you to come to Him. Jesus said, come. Come unto me, all you who are labored and heavy laden. I'll give you rest. Some of you are laden down with your problems and your enemies and your prisons, your addictions. Jesus said, come to me. I'll give you rest. And so come to Jesus today and receive Him as Lord. And for Christians, as we prepare to come to this table, might be that you need to come and kneel at the altar and just say, Lord, thank you. Thank you for setting me free. Thank you for bringing joy into my life. Thank you for eternal life. Thank you for your broken body and shed blood. I come to worship you and to praise you. Some of us just need to fall on our faces and ask God, give me my joy back. Restore unto me, as the psalmist said, restore unto me the joy of your salvation. You come. Make that decision even now. Let's pray. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Think about what you need to do right now. And then when we sing, you do it. Father, thank you for Jesus, and thank you for the fact that He's the answer to every problem we have. He is the one who has said that we shall know the truth, and He said, I am the truth. We'll know the truth, and the truth would make us free. He's the one who says that He has victory over the one who is in the world. For greater is He who is in you than he who is in the world. God, remind us of these things today and restore our joy. For the lost in this place, I pray that you would bring joy to them for the very first time. That they might understand peace with God and eternal life through Jesus Christ. For saved people in this place, God, excite us. Fill us with joy and help us to want to serve you in the furtherance of the gospel, no matter what. Whether it presents problems or persecution or imprisonment, we just want to serve Jesus today. Bring us to that place in our lives, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing. I've decided to follow Jesus. You come.